everybody, and welcome back to the Moschix mainframe channel. This is Moschix. And if you remember, in the previous video, we had a guest speaker, if you want, Professor Renaud Ferland from Montreal. This is the video that we produced together, mostly, of course, him. 90% of the work was by him, where he showed how to install and operate DOS VSE, which is this lineature of operating systems, in kind of parallel to the MVS and then OS 3, 319 ZOS, and then the other third parallel on the mainframe would be VM, and then VMXA, VMESA, and CVM. Now, as he explained in the video, let's go have a look here. The DOS VS operating system is a pure batch operating system. You do have the console that you see here on the left side, the amber colored text, but that's just one screen that is run by the operator to start and stop jobs and reconfigure the system. And there's no interactive mode whatsoever in DOS VS. And so a lot of people have always, over the past 50 years or so, 40, 50 years, always run DOS VS under VM 370 or any more modern implementation of VM 370, for the reason that you can VM 370 is able to run guest operating systems, and of course DOS VS is one of the most widely used guest operating systems in VM 370. And since VM 370 is by definition a time sharing system also, with full screen editors and all that kind of stuff, it makes a lot of sense to use VM 370 for all the interactive work, for instance editing programs and editing scripts and configuring data and all that kind of stuff, and then submit it through VM 370 to DOS VS. And what Renaud Ferland did by doing that is kind of showing how you can turn DOS VS in an interactive system by using the VM 370 interactive facilities. So also in this video, Renaud Ferland showed that while we do have an excellent implementation of DOS VS, there are some shortcomings there, such as being, as it comes delivered, not being able to run COBOL or PL1 compilers. And in this installment today, Professor Renaud Ferland is going to show how to fix things so that we are able, in fact, to write and compile and execute COBOL and PL1 language programs. And so this is what we're going to do today. And Renaud, thank you. Renaud, thank you very much again for offering to make this guest videos. And over to you, Renaud. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. This is Renaud from Montreal. And this is my second video on the OS VS. All right, so last time I let you on some kind of cliffhanger, because I told you if you download, install an IPL system, a DOS VS system, the way I just did, you won't be able to compile PL1 programs and COBOL programs for that matter. So I also told you that I would show you how to tweak the system to get around this problem. So let's do that in this particular video. All right, now I have in front of me a freshly IPL DOS VS system, the way I just showed you. I increase a little bit the size of the windows in the front, so that's going to be easier for you maybe to read what's on the screen, understand what I'm typing. So the first thing we want to do, as you can see, the reader is okay. So now we want to submit a PL1 program and see what happens, okay? So I'm gonna go to this window. That's the CMS user virtual machine. If I look at the files here, let's see. You can see my ELO DOS VS file. So let's take a look at this one. Type ELO DOS VS. Now that's a job, a PL1 program, the ELO World PO program in PL1, essentially. So here's the exec for the compile, link it in the execution. So what I have to do now, remember, I have to spool the punch to DOS VS. I do that only once, and then I punch my job without a header and see what happens. Okay. Now if you look here, you can see that I get a message to the effect that no valid storage assignment in final phase, job LO canceled due to program requests, and apparently something wrong happened during the compile and execution. So let's see what happened by looking at the listing. So I'm gonna open this. I'm gonna run, which job? So it's job 109. So let me cut the paper for that job like this. And then open this so you're gonna see better. That should be pretty clear now. So this is the banner, that's fine. Good, 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 good. And then here it is. So it starts, it tries to execute the PL1 compiler here. And then I get this message, T not the same or wrong medium types for sys001, sys002, sys003. And actually there is absolutely no listing, no compilation whatsoever. So since the compiler is not compiling, it's not producing an object module and everything goes bad after that. That's why we got this message from the link editor and execution afterwards. Okay, so the link editor is not getting any link module, so he cannot do his job and things go down the drain after that. Okay, so essentially the compiler did not compile at all because of this reason here. So let me try to explain a little bit what it means. It happens that this compiler, the US PL1 compiler we have here, it needs work files to do its job. And these work files should be stored on a specific kind of DASD, namely a 2314 DASD. However, on this particular 5-pack of George Shedlock, the work files are stored on a 3350 DASD. That's a later model. So because the PL1 compiler cannot find the proper kind of DASD for the work files, it just refused to compile and that's it. Well, the reason for that, I guess, is because this compiler that there is on the OSVS is actually an older compiler from DOS 360. You can see probably the 360N here means that anyway. So it's a little bit like on MVS where we have a PL1 compiler, but it's a PL1 compiler from MVT, the previous version of the OS operating system. And over here, the situation is the same. The compiler we have for PL1 is a compiler of DOS 360, and this is an older system that works on older kinds of DASDs. So essentially, the work files are stored on a 3350, a DASD that this compiler does not recognize. And that's why we can't compile. Okay, so I'm gonna close this, come back here. So what can be done for that? Well, I guess there are, let me clear this maybe, there are two ways to do. Either you change the software to deal with the kind of hardware you have, or you change the hardware to deal with the kind of software you have. So either you patch the compiler so that it's gonna be able to deal with the work files on a 3350 DASD, or on the other hand, you might change the 3350 DASD for a 2314 DASD where you're gonna store the work files and then the compiler will be able to do his job. So I'm gonna explore both ways and probably the second one in the first place. So that's probably the easiest, well, not the easiest way, but I would say that was the way I could do it at first, because it's not difficult to change the DASD and arrange things for that. Patch a compiler is a little bit different and might be more difficult. So let's try to go into this direction where we're gonna define a DASD, a 2314 DASD, add it to the system and store the work files on it, okay? So for that, I need first to create a 2314 DASD and add it to the system. This job has nothing to do with the compilers anyway. It's just an example of how to add a DASD to a system. So let's explore this thing in the first place. For that purpose, I need to shut down my system because I will need to create a DASD, update the configuration file of Hercules and so on. So let's bring down this whole thing. So I'm gonna first to shut down my logon, my CMS user virtual machine, log off this way. And then pend, I'm gonna do the steps one after another without explaining. Unbatch, unbatch, ROD, now we can do the unbatch and stop. Back to logon console, okay, I'm gonna clear this, I'm gonna do sharp CP, and then reset F, and then log off, good. And then with this, let me go put this back here. Then remember on VM370, we have to do the slash shutdown first, very important, and then stop and quit. Okay, now I clear this. I have to add a DASD at this point, okay, a 2314 DASD. So I'm gonna go into the disk folder and I'm gonna create a DASD there. So here's the command, DASD init. I'm gonna use a compressed DASD, so dash z. But then you need to type dash a dash r. This is important because the job to initialize expect the DASD to have alternate cylinders and no vol ser essentially. So we do that. Then the name of the DASD, so I'm gonna call it work 02.23.cckd, and that's a 2314. Good. Now I have this. If I do DASDLS on this guy, you can see that there is no vol ser for the moment, but that's okay because the initialization will put a DASD, will put a vol ser on this DASD. So now I go up and I have to add the DASD to the VM370 configuration file. Okay, so I'm gonna edit my Hercules configuration file. F. Okay, so here are the DASD of DOSVS. I'm gonna put the second work file, work DASD after that. I need an address. Now, I'm gonna tell you the address and explain to you where to get the information for that. So I'm gonna add 0230. That's not gonna be a 3350, but a 2314 disk. And then the name was work 02. 2314, that's CCKD. Good. And now I have the system, not the system, that's the on the system. So let's IPL VM370 to see what happens. Hercules. Well, he found the DASD, that's good. I'm waiting for this command complete here. Then, if you remember, we have to start all, otherwise nothing will get printed. And then I'm gonna do a query DASD free. And you can see again the DASDs of the DOSVS system here. But then here, you see DASD 230 free. That's the new DASD we just add, and there is no vol ser, that's why we have the word free over here. Okay. So now, what I want to do, I want to start my DOSVS virtual machine, but I need this DASD to be connected to the virtual machine. So I will first update the directory, the VM directory, to add this DASD to the virtual machine we already have. And after that, I'll be able to initialize this DASD to use it on the system. So first step first, we need to update the directory. So I'm gonna open a 3270 connection. I'm gonna log on maint, the root, log on main, password is cpcms. Good. Like this. And I have to update the directory. Now the directory, sorry, direct like this. There are three direct files. This is the old directory of the 5-pack that preceded the 6-pack. This is the directory of the 6-pack. And this is the directory entry of the DOSVS virtual machine, but you don't update this guy. You have to update 6-pack direct. Okay? So maybe what I'm gonna do is just copy this guy, 6-pack direct A, into, let's say, my name, bang bang, like this. And I'm gonna edit this guy so that the 6-pack won't be changed. The original 6-pack directory file won't be changed, but you can edit this one if you wish. But if I keep it, I can always, you know, restore the system to its original state. So that's what I prefer. So now I'm gonna edit this guy. And that's the directory, the VM directory of the system. Now I have to update the DOSVS entry. And remember, we had a few error message when we IPL DOS VS, so maybe we can use this occasion to maybe correct the, fix the entry of DOS VS. So I'm gonna do first a slash DOS VS just to find the entry. Here it is. Now the highlight line is the current one. First thing first, I want to change this 8 meg here for 4 meg. So let me change 8 meg for 4 meg. Down one line, I want to remove that virtual equal real here. That's the part of the directory entry that gives this message at, when we log on. So let's remove this virtual equal real and replace this by BMX. Block multiplexing down. Let's change 190 for CMS. Now this is good, this also. Now I'm gonna add a line. I'm gonna add a dedicate statement for my DASD. So let's input dedicate. Now the DASD will be on virtual address 130 and real address 230. Oop. Input dedicate, sorry, dedicate 130 230. Good. Return down. Remember, there was a message regarding minidisc U, so I'm gonna deal that with that also. Input link maint 190 190 RR. Down, down, down. There's a special statement here we don't need, so let's delete it. And that should be it, I guess. So let's file and then update the directory direct parallel. And that's good. So now the directory is okay. I'm ready to log on into DOSVS and initialize that DASD. So I'm gonna log off from this and maybe quit this completely. Let's go back here and open a terminal, a bigger one like this. Hope you like it. And then let's log on onto DOSVS. And the password is DOSVS. See no more message, the VM read, I type return, no more message with respect to the U because now it's there and everything's fine. So I'm gonna clear this Now let me do a query virtual DASD. Now you see the DASDs starting with 19, those are the DASD of CMS, and you have the DASDs of DOSVS, and you have this new DASD we just added, DASD 130. And we want to initialize this DASD, okay? So to do so, we're gonna run a job, but not a job on CMS like this. We're gonna run a job on DOSVS, because this, we want to initialize the as a DOS disk, not as a CP disk or an MVS disk or something like that. So we need an initialization job for a DOS disk. So I have to start my DOSVS system, but maybe this is the good time to talk about something. Remember, when we start the DOSVS system, we end up with this message regarding the reader and we had to run a job for it. That's okay, but maybe we can be we can take care of this before IPLing. So I'm gonna show you what we can do. First of all, I'm gonna create a file containing a job that does nothing, because all we need to know is run a job, but we don't need to do anything with the job. So I'm gonna create this job. So it's gonna be very simple, / job nothing. And indeed I do nothing. So I close the job right after that. So this is the minimum job I can do on a DOSVS system. It does nothing. There's no need to run a program. It's just I start a job and I stop it right away. Okay, like this. So we have this nothing job, and the idea is to punch this job in the virtual reader on the of the machine, so that when we IPL DOSVS and is looking for something in the card reader, there will be something in the card reader. So we won't get that message we used to get if there's nothing in the card reader. But for that, we have to punch this job in the card reader, and the card reader of the DOSVS virtual machine. So I have to spool. I'm not gonna spool like this. I'm gonna create a small exec that is gonna do that. So edit, let's say .cipl exec. This is the equivalent of a script or something like that, or a C list on MVS. Input. Now I'm gonna spool the punch to DOSVS. I'm gonna punch my nothing job without a header, because otherwise the DOSVS won't be able to recognize that header anyway. And I'm gonna spool back my punch for the DOSVS so that I can use the punch to actually punch something, not in the card reader, but on the punch of the system. And then I'm gonna IPL 360 like this to start my IPL. Okay, so I'm in input mode, so it's file and clear. And now I'm ready to IPL my system. So let's do that. I just type DOS IPL. This exec will be available for the next time now. And I have my IPL 360 and the running message here, so everything's fine. Now I have to connect a console and finish the IPL. So I will do this again without too many explanations, so it's gonna go faster. The terminal like this, the DOSVS, and let's go. One, set, DPD, keep. Now be careful here. Don't press enter a second time, because that will trigger the execution of the nothing job, and I don't want that. I want it to be available when I start power. So I have to stop. Then I bash F1. Well, before maybe. Start this, it should go right system is still working here. Let's be patient. See, now there's no message, no error message like before. Okay, we have reader waiting for work, that's fine. So now we assign, this is in the partitions. My job, nothing is there, nothing happened. Then I'm gonna release, P release from the reader, all the jobs starting from XX. And I'm gonna P delete everything. Okay, so now if I do P display A, everything is fine here. If I do P display RDR, I have my jobs, P display, they all okay, things are okay. I still can't compile PL1 programs. Now what I want to do is initialize my DASD. So there is a job for that. Let me go here. So okay, so I go to one new. What's in there? There is a init 2314 DASD. Okay, so let's take a look at it a little bit. More sys like this. As you can see, first of all, my first line is user ID, because I'm gonna submit this job to the card reader of VM and then send it to the card reader of DOS VS. And then we have the statements of power. And then we have the JCL that runs this program, INTDK, that's the program to initialize the disk. Those are the parameters. I will put the VTOC at some cylinder, and this is the vol serre for the DASD. So I need to run this job on the OSVS. Now I have initialized my reader here to a socket, so I can submit a job to that socket. And I wrote myself a small script to do that. So I should do a submit. Oh, let me put the console here. So that thing, and if everything's fine, it will initialize the disk. That seems to be working. See VM working here. And I'm done initializing the disk. Let's see what it shows on the listing. That's job 112. I will enlarge this. Okay, the banner again of DOS VS of VM370 for that virtual machine. And then a little bit later, power, that's fine. Still have the. Here it is. Job init disk initialize. It runs this. Start the utility modifier card, label control set, blah blah blah, and end of initialization disk. So everything went fine. So that's good. Now we have a disk. Now I cannot see it here. You know, if I do a query DASD pre, I won't see it for the good reason that it's dedicated to this virtual machine. So it's no longer free. That's fine, but it's there and it's initialized. Now DOS VS knows about it. It's the right format, so I can store my work files on it. So let me show now. Let me show you what will happen from this point. Okay, so let me clear this. Now, to understand what we have to do, we have to remember what I told you. When you have a data set on DOS VS, you need two things to identify this data set somehow to the system. We need a label that will connect the name of the data set and the extent where to a logical unit. And we need an assignment that connect the logical unit to the physical unit, whereas the data set is located. So that's true for the work files too. Now, where are the labels and the assignments for the work files so far on this DOSVS system, unmodified for the moment? Well, the labels are located on the on disk in a special cylinder for that, and the assignments, they are actually hard-coded in the supervisor. So if I want to change this, somehow I have to change the labels on the disk, and I have possibly to reassemble the supervisor. That's not such a hard thing to do, but maybe then we're not gonna go up to this point because we have to learn a little bit more about labels. So let me explain. There are three kinds of labels on DOSVS. There are the standard labels. Those are the labels that all the partitions knows about. There are the partition labels. Those are the labels that only the partition on which they are defined knows, you know. And there are the user labels, and these are the labels I can define in a job, and they will be enforced only for the duration of that job. So, if I want to change the labels and the assignments of the work files, I can do it at the user level, the partition level, or the system level, the standard label levels. So let me do these things one after another. So I will show you. So where am I? I'm on this thing. So let's check. Okay, so to temp, let me go into this directory. You can see two jobs here. There's a first job, PL1 DOMC. Now Moshix has a NQueen PL1 program, and I have a DOMC PL1 program. That's my fetish program. So let me try to run this DOMC program here. So I'm gonna do a more of this just for you to see it a little bit. So I still have my user ID, DOSVS card, the first thing, because I want VM370 to know to which virtual reader to send this job. And then you see a typical PL1 job, the statements for power, then the JCL, then the exec PL1, blah, blah. So normally if I submit this job to the card reader via the socket, you know, it won't work. So let's see what happens. We just added a DASD, but we haven't changed anything. So I'm gonna submit this job, okay. And I get the same message as before, no valid storage assignment because the compilation didn't occur. Okay, so what can I do? If I look here, there's a PL1 DOMCE for extended maybe. And let's take a look at it. Let's do more PL1. Now, if you look at it carefully now, you can see that at first, before going to the compile, I performed these assignments here and these define labels for the work file 1, work file 2, work file 3. You know, so I just define user labels for the work files, and after that I'm gonna compile. So these labels and assignments will be enforced for the duration of the job. That's enough for me, and normally it should be enough for the job to run and for the program to compile. Okay, so let me clear the console here first and submit this job. Now, not the original one, but this one. Now, as you can see, it defines the work files, compile, it works, link it, and go execute, and now it's executing. It takes some time. It ends fine. So now, everything works because I have properly defined the work files. Okay, so let me take a look at this, the output of this job. So I'm gonna cut the paper like this and enlarge this. the M370 banner. Where is this? Oh, that's the old job. Okay, here it is. I was surprised not to see that. So now I have the old job because I haven't cut the paper from the old job. Now, as you can see here, the definition, the assignments, and the definition of the labels, and then it started executing the PL1 compiler. And this time I'm gonna get my listing. That's a long listing. It computes the price of a dine and out option. It's a financial derivative. Successful compilation, that's good. Then linked it, then execution, and then I got the result here. The price is $17 essentially, and we have the French name of the option. So it's the price of a down and out call option, and in French it's option d'achat avec barrière désactivante. So that's what it is. So everything goes fine now. So what it means is that if you want, you can add these definition for each job you have, and these definitions works also for the COBOL compiler, and it's gonna work. But maybe it's a little bit annoying to put this all the time with it, each and every job we run. So a second possibility is to store these labels as partition labels for the duration, not of a job, but let's say a session on DOSVS. So you IPL the system, you store these labels into the partition labels of the of BG for that matter, you compile and do your work, and when you're done you just put things back to what they were and you shut down the system. So that's another possibility, and I do that. That's the one I use normally, because the good thing about it is that if you change, you tweak the system for the time of the session, you can do whatever you want during the session. And then when you put it back, you have an original DOSVS system that you can do whatever you want with, including not changing the work files definitions, because you might not want to do that in another session. Okay, so let me go show you what it means. So what do we have? Okay, so three sessions. I have two jobs here plus my DL1, PL1, DOMC. That's the original job without the definition, you know? The one that doesn't work if I don't change those work files. And then you have this job here, SysWK2314. So let's take a look. More. Is this not like this? Now, this is a job that only does the assignment and the definition of the labels. But now you can see that in front of this assigned keyword, there's no slash slash double slash. What it means is that now this assignment will be in force on the system as long as I don't change them for something else. And it will disappear at the end of the session when I will shut down the system. So by instead of having a slash like this, and it works only for the duration of the job, without the slash, it's gonna last as long as I don't change them. And then after that, I have my DLBL, but there is an option here just before. And that means store these things into the partition label, so they will be available for the duration of the session, essentially. So let me do that. So I just have to submit this job. And now I can run my PL1 program without any problem. So remember this more PL1. This program here calls the compiler right away without any further previous definition. So remember that in the beginning it didn't work, but now that I have run this job, it should work. Okay, so let me submit the job. And you see, it compiles, linked it, and go execute. So My previous job just set up the whole thing, and now I can compile as many PL1 program as I want. I can compile as many COBOL program as I want. And this is going to work also for Fortran and Assembler anyway. So at this point, I have a system that's ready to compile whatever I want in BG, which is normally the partition in which we compile. Okay, but as I said, it's a better practice to restore the labels and the assignments to their original value before shutting down the system. And that's pretty easy. There's a job for it. So let me show you. I called it work 3350. So as you can see, I restore these assignments to what they are normally in the 5-pack. 362 is the work file, the 3350 work DASD. And then I do this option parsed with nothing, which will erase actually the label. So if I run this, let me submit this job again. I just reset the logical units and erase the labels, which means now that if I submit my PL1 program, it shouldn't work because now the work files are back on the 3350 DASD, so let me submit my PL1 program. And as you can see, I got this no valid storage assignment now. It's not working because the work files are not at the right place. Now the system is back to what it is normally after IPL. So that's a second solution, as I said. The first one was to do the assignments and the label definition in every job. The second is to store this into the partition labels and do some permanent assignment for the duration of the session. The third one would be to the permanent solution, what I call the permanent solution. Let me show you. You need to I told you that the assignments are hard-coded into the supervisor. When I run a job and I do this partial assignment, it's going to oversee this hard-coded assignment. But if I don't want to do that and I want the assignments to be hard-coded into the supervisor, it means I have to reassemble the supervisor. So there is a job here, which I'm not going to run, but can make it available to everyone. This is the supervisor of the DOSVS system, and you have to run this job first. Let me maybe do some more. One. So that's an assembly. There's a macro with all kinds of definitions here, and you have the definitions of the different piece of hardware here. And let me show you at the end. You're gonna see these are the assignments, you can see. And now I have changed the assignments. And then this macro generate the supervisor and link edit it to store it in the core image library. You know? I could use a different name, but probably a better thing is to use the same name. But I'm not going to change the supervisor of this one because I'm quite fine with my second solution. But anyway, you can do that. But that's not enough because this is going to change the assignments. I still have to change the labels. And if you look at it, there's a second job, EXT label. That job will change the labels on the cylinder, the system cylinder that stores the standard labels, and we can use it. And if you run these two jobs, you know, after that you will always be able to compile and link edit COBOL program in any compiler without any further stuff to do. So that might be a solution you like anyway. So that's one thing. Okay. So that was the second part, where I told you that you could change the hardware to accommodate or to handle the kind of software we have, the first solution was to patch the compiler. Patch the compiler means just change the compiler in such a way that after that, it will accept, you know, a work file on a 3350 NASD. So that's possible, but I don't think we have the source of the compiler. We have the compiler, it's in the public domain, but the source of that compiler, I'm not sure. Anyway, so one possibility, if you don't have the source of the compiler, is to zap the phase of the compiler. The phase in the USVS is the name of an executable file, you know. So one thing you can do if you don't have the source, I'm not sure, maybe we have the source, but I'm not sure. We can zap the phase, we can patch the phase directly, you know. Of course, we need to know exactly where in the phase to change stuff. And as knowledgeable that people think I am, I don't know where to change the phase, you know, to patch it for the work files. That's not to say that I haven't patched a compiler in the past, but for this compiler or the other ones, I don't know how to patch the compiler, but someone knew how to do it and made some job available for that. So let me show you. That's okay. So that's 6 or 5 patch. There are 2 jobs here which I will make available. Well, I will give them to Moshix and he will, I assume, put it on his GitHub anyway. So let me show you that one, maybe more PL1 patch. I'm not gonna run it. So as you see, these patch apply to PL1 receive on blah blah blah. The first jump will change what happens when there is a T-level diagnostic, but there's a lot of explanation. And after that, it runs a program called PDZap that's gonna change the phase itself, you know. And this is the original version. That's the replacement. This specific address over here and stuff like that. So we have to know about it, but I don't. Anyway, we just run it and it's gonna be okay. But of course, I don't know how to unpatch such a compiler. So if you run this job, this will patch the compiler. And after that, you know, it's gonna be okay, but you cannot unpatch it. I don't have a job to unpatch it if you would like to unpatch it. So if you want an original compiler, you have to, you know, start over, maybe make a copy of your system before so that you keep a version on the original version of the compiler and stuff like that. And I have a job for the PL1 and the COBOL compiler, actually the F COBOL compiler, but there are 2 COBOL compilers on the OSVS. So that COBOL patch here is for the F COBOL, the most recent one, but there's also a D COBOL. The patch is no good for that compiler, so you're still into trouble for that one. It's also possible to install an RPG compiler on the USVS, and there is a patch for that one too. You don't need to patch Fortran and Assembler because they work fine with 3350 NASD's work file, but these two we can do. However, the solution I presented before, you know, changing the DASD, that's going to work with all the compilers whatsoever, you know, so, because these are all compilers and that's fine. So, okay, so that's what I wanted to tell you. Either you change the job, you change for the session, or you make a permanent change. I personally work with the session change, but you can do whatever you want. And these jobs I will give to Moshix so that he can put them on the on his GitHubs and he can use them if you wish. Okay, so that's gonna conclude this particular video. Again, pretty long one, 46 minutes or 50 minutes, but anyway, I'm a university teacher, you know, so I'm used to teach for an hour and a half and I have no problem teaching, speaking for an hour and a half. And that's kind of program for that, I guess. So maybe that's the reason why I have these long videos anyway. But so this is it. Now the next video, if there is one and people are interested in it, I'm going to talk about CMS DOS, and I'm going to talk about the DOS VS system that's available on the Moshix cloud, you know, because I put one there. we're going to see a little bit of what's going on there. What I showed you is for you to install on a personal copy of the OSVS running under VM370 at home. And maybe there are some stuff to say about this VM370, because you're going to see that if you download this syspack and you try to work with it, it's not going to be exactly the same as what's going on the cloud of Moshik. So maybe I'm going to tell you a little bit about this and what are the difference and why we have a full screen editor on the cloud and we don't have it over here. Okay, so that's about it for the moment.
Well, thank you very much, René. This was an extremely interesting video. I learned a bunch of things, and I'm sure our viewers learned a lot of things too. I did follow your instructions. I did get things to work. You mentioned that the six pack that you run and I run on our Moshik mainframe in the cloud is different than the six pack that people would download from the web, especially because we have a full screen editor and a full screen file list and some other enhancements. That is all true, and I hope you're going to make that video for us to all see how to make full screen editing and all the other good things work for VM37. This is the mainframe in the cloud that Romanu was referring to in the video. As you can see, I just re-IPL'd just half an hour ago after I backed up. I created about 20-30 accounts that people have been asking for over the last 2-3 weeks, and so we probably have right by now about 30-40 users on the system. We released this about a month ago, and on the MVS 3.8 mainframe in the cloud, we have about 140 users. So this has been running faultlessly for many months on the MVS side, and about a month, month and a half on the VM370 side. You can see here there's a user logged in, Nico39. That's one of the users I just created today. Everybody can get an account by following the instructions I already posted a couple of times in this video. Go with your browser to moshiks.dainu.net, ask for an account there, put in your real name, desired all the information required on the form, and you'll be granted an account. If people behave, they can stay on forever. It's all free, obviously. Now and then on the MVS side, I've had one or two users not behaving according to the rules, and I had to deactivate them. But overall, this has been a very friendly, very innovative and creative community. So again, thank you, René. We look forward to your next video. I myself have a bunch of videos in the making, some VM370 related, but also about an idea that I'm working on with some people and together with René Ferland on something truly game-changing for the Hercules emulator community. But more about that in the next video. Thank you for watching. If you like this particular video, especially if you like the very good work that René put in this video, press on the thumbs up button. People are always happy to see recognition for the work. If you haven't subscribed to the Moshik's mainframe channel yet, please subscribe now. And if not, I'll see if you already subscribed, then thank you. And otherwise, we'll see you in the next video. Thank you and goodbye.